If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
I'm so ready, ready to rock. Yeah.
Whoa, dude.
Oh.
In this
stadium
rocking episode of Mind Pump,
we're back.
Adam, Justin, and I have our usual conversation for the first
LA, we love you.
For the first 30 minutes of our intro, we talk about the influenza epidemic here in California.
I had no idea. It was killing people.
It's getting crazy. By the way, I talk about elderberry.
Get your elderberry.
Elderberry does, in clinical studies, has been shown to fight the influenza virus. You can get elderberry at Thrive Market, one of our sponsors. By the way, if you go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump, this is what you'll get. 1 month free membership, $20 off your first three orders of $49 or more, and free shipping. We talk about the LA Fit Expo. Me and Adam went down there, had a good time, met a lot of awesome
shake hands,
fans,
kiss babies,
friends, talked a little shit about most supplements in the belly of the beast.
Fucking Sal big timed me while we were there.
Yep, we talk about how I big timed him. And then we talk about me pooping at a girl's house.
What?
Throwing you under the bus.
As soon as they walk in.
A great way to make a good first impression.
We talk about the Organifi Kermit blend.
Oh, we're going to start a new thing. We got the Christmas blend. Now we got the Kermit blend.
So the Kermit
Here's
blend.
How you put it together.
The Kermit blend, one of our fans named it that, by
I'm going to reach out to Shauna and see what's up, man. I think we should get some graphics maybe done around some of this stuff.
I think so. That's a good idea. Move some product.
What do you think, Organifi?
So the Kermit blend is Organifi green juice mixed with Organifi gold juice. Tastes amazing. Very relaxing. It's got all the adaptogenics in there. Good stuff. If you go to OrganifiShop.com, enter the code MindPump without a space, you will get a massive discount. We also talk about Justin staying behind and finishing up our new MAPS program.
Somebody's got to keep us moving forward.
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
You might be getting a new MAPS program this month.
Uh-oh.
Then we get into the questions. The first question was, this individual injured their Achilles tendon and they think it sucks really bad. They don't want to move because they're scared they might re-tear it. They were wondering about Adam's protocol for healing his Achilles tendon rupture.
They did it just to comfort Adam.
I got you, bro. I got you.
It involves a lot of diddling. Next question. What were our thoughts on all the resistance tubes and bands that girls are wearing around their legs while they're doing their leg workouts? Are they doing something good or are they being stupid again? Next question. What do we think about cycling different diets seasonally throughout the year?
I like this idea.
The example this person gives us is, you know, high fat and keto and bone broth in the winter, paleo in the fall, vegan in the spring, and carb cycling in the summer. It does sound brilliant and genius. I see a money-making opportunity. Final question. If we could create a drinking game for listening to Mind Pump, what would those rules be?
What would those rules be? I'm fascinated to find out.
Let's get drunk.
Absolutely. Also, it's January.
I'm drinking right now.
It's January. We love giving shit out for free in January. So here's what you'll get for free in January from Mind Pump. You'll get a free t-shirt. All you got to do is enroll in any of our bundles.
That's not the only thing we're giving away for free. Don't forget about the YouTube channel.
Oh, well, YouTube, we got the free workout on YouTube.
Absolutely.
If you want to get more into your workouts, you want more expert programming, then you enroll in one of our MAPS programs. If you get a bundle, you'll get a free t-shirt.
Now, turd? You're going to give him a turd?
Oh, listen, yeah.
We'll always give you a turd. No problem.
Buy our bundles. We got some shit for you.
Yeah.
Exactly. Sal will drop it off at your house.
You'll get either,
before he meets you,
either
apparently.
A turd or a t-shirt. You'll be to find out which you'll get, you need to enroll in a bundle.
Hot, steaming turd. The one, coming your way.
The one that the bundle that we recommend the most, of course, is our super bundle. It's 1 year of exercise programming. So, in other words, if you enroll in the super bundle, you have about 12 months, roughly 12 months planned out for you. So with different phases, different workouts, exercise demos taught by three experienced personal trainers, you're going through different phases, different adaptations. It never gets boring. Your body progresses the entire time. It's the most comprehensive workout bundle system in existence.
Ever existed.
Ever.
Ever.
Ever. Based ever. On us. To enroll in the bundle, to get a free t-shirt or turd,
I prefer t-shirt.
One of those. Just go to mindpumpmedia.com.
Oh, what do we got for these guys? Douglas, what do we got today?
How many reviews?
Here, we've got 20 reviews this week.
Wow, and we haven't called for it for a minute there, Sal.
No, actually, I think the last time I gave directions, that makes a big difference.
A Zach Bush interview you did?
No,
this is
the last time
week.
We did the iTunes review.
Oh, the last time you did iTunes.
People still have a tough time figuring out how to leave a review.
Because it's a
mystery.
It's gotten better, though. iTunes has gotten better.
How, really?
No, the new platform is better. It's easier than what it was before. Before it was a pain in the ass.
Well, you get a good chance of winning a t-shirt.
22, Doug, huh?
No, 20.
20.
But we're giving away 6 shirts.
Damn, hooking them up.
Yeah. So let me read these off. It's Surf and Turf 7.
Yeah.
Seagrass. Dinosaur RN.
Wow.
Michelle 0890.
Friend of hers.
Baron Body. Mr. Super Luke. All of you are winners. So send the name I just read to iTunes@mindpumpmedia.com. Send your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to
you. Thank you.
Hooking it up. I tried some of this weekend for the first time when Sal did it before
it's fucking good,
his
huh?
whatchamacallit. Yeah, no, it was, I mean, crazy. It's crazy how good it is.
Right?
It's a very refreshing drink. And I already like the green. And I already like the red. The fucking gold's even better.
So you know how you mix, when you mix.
I'm not a fan of the red.
You know how you mix the red's good. You know when you mix the red with the green, we call it the Christmas blend.
Oh, yeah, I haven't tried that yet.
So now if you mix the green with the gold, because I did that, I do that all the time. It's my favorite combo.
Yeah.
They call that the Kermit blend.
Who's they?
I know him.
No, hold on a second.
He's gonna start
no,
it.
No.
Oh, so oh they somebody else.
Somebody else. I showed you.
There's
fucker.
A group on the internet. I actually saw it on Reddit.
I showed you. I showed you the person who did it. Dude.
Oh,
somebody called it the Kermit blend.
This
Kermit
guy. Blend. Yeah, I like it though. I like it though. I like the Kermit blend and the Christmas blend. We're starting a little thing here with it. Tell our Organifi sponsor what's up. Like, hey, you guys, we need to put this together. Maybe put some graphics behind it. Face of Sal with there like Kermit legs and stuff. Or
here's
Kermit
how
body.
You're going to do it.
Yeah.
You know, just like this.
Do we do the Sal body Kermit head or do we do the Kermit body Sal's head?
I say God. Sal body Kermit head.
No. Sal. Oh, wow. You don't like my face, huh?
No. I didn't say that.
Hide his face.
I like Kermit's face.
It's a good combination because it has, they're both these relaxing, they both contain these relaxing herbs. So what I do is I drink those, then I have some caffeine and I get this real fucking nice smooth buzz.
Yeah.
And that's what we did. I drank it before we went, and I also
saw your Insta story.
I also drank something bad. What? People called it out, actually. So when Adam posted the video of me drinking the Kermit blend or whatever you want to call it, in the background was a little 5-hour energy bottle.
Hell of people calling him out.
Hell of people are like,
they're all DMing me like, is that a 5-hour? Did Sal drink that? I said, no, he snorted it right after the fucking Kermit blend.
So I have...
I got you, bitch!
Yeah.
We do so much traveling, right? And I have my yellow backpack that I always use. And sometimes we'll be at gas stations and I don't, there's no coffee or whatever, the coffee's shit. And sometimes it's my guilty pleasure. I'll take a 5-hour energy, twice a year at least. This thing was in there and it had been in there for a long time. So I pulled it out.
Oh,
I'm like, I'm going to combine
this.
I'm going to take everything in the spirit of Fit Expo.
Right.
Let's just take all the supplements.
Right. You're trying to be nice and jacked.
Dude, speaking of, I didn't send it to you guys. This flu season is
aggressive.
They said it's the worst one in something like 5 or 10 years so far.
Hmm.
There's already been 27 deaths in California.
Get the fuck out of here.
In California.
Deaths?
Yes.
Wow.
From the flu?
What are you,
were they like 80 or 90?
Yeah.
No. 27 people under the age of 65 that died.
Get out of here.
So it's not as bad as that. Remember when that H1N1 virus was out and it was getting bad?
Yeah.
That one resulted in 300-something deaths in California. So people don't realize this. Shit tons of people still die from the flu every year.
That's crazy to me.
You can't just
fight that?
Yeah, I didn't. I mean, are you including people that are like 80 or 90, though, that are about to die anyways, and then the flu's like what fucking does it?
It must be like compromised people to begin with.
So there are categories of people that are more likely to die, but one of these categories of people is actually young, healthy people because if it's a particular strain of influenza that hasn't been around for 40 years, and then it comes out all of a sudden, and you're a 30-year-old athlete or whatever, maybe you're training really hard, maybe you're stressed out at work, so your immune system's a little depressed, then you get this virus that hits your body that your body's never seen anything like it. It can hit you very hard, and you can actually be more susceptible to death than somebody who's, say, 55 or 60, who may have been exposed to a virus, you know, a strain that's similar to it.
Mm.
How fucking crazy is that?
That is crazy.
But yeah, people die. So what I recommend is elderberry. Yeah. Elderberry is and Thrive Market actually has the Sambucus one, which is the one that's in the clinical trials.
Mm.
That's the one I recommend. So
that, isn't that the one, shout out to our Nature Way company?
Yeah, they actually sent us a bunch of them. Thank you.
Oh, yeah, thanks. I actually took some of that, too, for me and Courtney. And
well, no, I swooped it up. Yeah. I mean, I'm still just coming off of this one right now. It's bad. Everyone
saves the day.
So oh, you, can
perfect
actually,
timing.
You can actually, so I did this morning, because I was talking this with Jessica this morning, and she's like, yeah, but what do the studies actually say? Because I keep telling her this. So I looked them up, and you can find these on PubMed. These are actual double-blind, placebo-controlled studies that show, on average, a reduction in symptoms of the flu by 4 days. 4 fucking days.
That's a big deal, because the flu is normally like a 7-day thing anyways. You know, that's a huge deal.
Right, so it's the difference between having a fever and feeling shitty for 2 or 3 days or feeling shitty for 7 days.
Wow.
And
wow, that's a big difference.
That's a big difference. And the reduction in respiratory infection.
Did you look that shit up? Was it some bullshit bias study, though, that was put on by some company that actually sells?
No, there's been several.
Oh, okay.
There's been several.
Was PubMed? Did you say PubMed?
You can do PubMed, yes.
Okay.
And one of them is relatively...
Okay, I believe you.
One of them is relatively recent. But they show that not only that, but so one of the reasons, one of the ways that the influenza kills people is the virus itself doesn't kill you. It's the secondary infections that come after. So now you've got this virus that's fucking you up big time. You've got a horrible fever. Then you get pneumonia or bronchitis or some kind of bacterial infection or secondary infection, which then you're in this weakened state and it fucks you up. Elderberry was also shown to dramatically, like statistically dramatically reduce the instance of secondary respiratory infection. So taking elderberry prophylactically, meaning, you know, before you get anything,
right,
is probably a good idea.
Preventative mindset.
And what they're showing in these studies is that whatever's in elderberry, and I don't remember what it is, but there's something in elderberry in particular that increases the amount of cytokines in your system.
Is there a cutoff? Is there a cutoff period at what point, like, it doesn't fucking matter? Like, if you're already 2 days into the flu and stuff, and then you try and do that, would it still mitigate some things, or is it not?
That's a good question. So the way that they think it works, it'll probably help regardless.
Right.
But you're always going to be better off if you catch it before this virus just replicates and is all over the place. So, yeah, I would take it prophylactically a little bit every day throughout the whole season, which the season peaks in, I think I read, the second week of February is when you... So right now, we're in the middle of the ramping up of the flu.
So it's going to get worse.
So, way worse. So like,
sweet.
Dude, I was reading this article, like emergency rooms are getting flooded with people who have the flu.
Yeah.
Have you got... When's the last time you had the actual flu? Because I think a lot of times people get a bad cold and they think it's the flu.
It's been a year or two for me.
Yeah. It was that one time you guys called in and I was watching the Tony Robbins documentary on Netflix.
Made you emotional?
Yeah.
Do you guys get emotional when you're sick?
To myself.
Well, you know my MO.
Well, you get horny.
You watch pregnancy, right?
But do you also get emotional?
I
get horny and I watch teen pregnancy.
That's weird.
That's my MO. Yeah. I don't know what it is. I told you what I think it is. I mean, I don't know. I don't know for sure why I'm drawn to trash TV when I'm fucking sick, but I think it has something to do with seeing these other people like with much bigger struggles in their life than this little 7-day flu that I have.
Way worse.
Yeah, like, like, fuck, this could be worse. I could have 3 kids from 3 different fathers.
Next on, hoarders.
Like, living with my mother still, screaming at her, you know what I'm saying? Borrowing my fucking friend's car, like... Okay, it's not that bad. I'm down for 7 days. You know what I'm saying? I think it has something to do with that. And then the horny thing goes back to fucking high school.
Yeah.
Because when you were sick and you were home and mom wasn't home and girlfriend comes over and gives you a little handy.
Yeah, yeah. And then forever I've connected that, you know, laying in bed being not feeling
you
well.
You get the sympathy.
I can't be like when I'm like deathly sick and I got a headache, my head's spinning, I'm like throwing up, vomiting. Like there ain't no anything going on but that, hugging a pillow or whatever. But... Once you're in that, you know, because
your girl start. Does she try and take advantage of you now that she knows this? Like, if you're real sick?
Yeah, yeah, no, she will. Because she's always trying to get
give you a little diddle.
Yeah, Katrina's always trying to get some. And he says,
you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You're just in bed sick. Yeah. You give you a little diddle. Yeah.
And normally I'm like, I can't breathe, honey. I don't know. We're not going to do this right now. We're definitely not making out, that's for sure.
You can just lay there. It's cool.
Yeah. I don't want to go near your face.
Yeah.
Gives you the diddle.
So
no, I get generally more emotional if I'm really sick. It's like I don't know if my empathy goes through the roof.
Yeah, I've noticed that. Like something on TV, and you're just like, ooh,
dude. I was sick once, and I was watching this. I don't remember what it was. It was like some TV show where this kid. It wasn't even that fucking emotional. I was so embarrassed. Some kid did something good, like
yeah.
You know, got a good, it was like some TV show and the kid like was really struggling in school and then did really good. And I was just like, fuck, man. This is tough.
You did it.
This is tough. Yeah. Dude, that kid got a good grade on their spelling.
Justin, I wish you were with us at the airport because I had Sal push me around in the wheelchair.
Oh, yeah.
And our boy had finally met up with
figment,
Sal.
Figment of your imagination.
Did your story change, or did you actually, like, when people are asking you what you did to your foot?
Oh, dude, I told people that I got bit by an alligator and I was saving a baby. And a couple of kids were like, really? Like, really? Where were you at? No, that's not the case at all.
Yeah, no, I was pushing. Dude, let's be honest now, Adam.
Dude, this
now
is,
that we're on the mic. Am I a good caretaker?
You actually, okay. I texted you, right? Did I not text you last night? I texted you private.
Thank God you had Sal, because I am horrible.
Well, I text, well, you know what? He's typically horrible.
I'm the best caretaker.
Yeah.
No, 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 no. If you're sick or injured around me, I'll take
it. I have a time limit.
I told Katrina before I left, I said, I'm really nervous about this trip because I know I'm kind of a fucking bear when I don't feel good. And I'm not only am I fucking sick, I'm dealing with this leg right now too. So I'm on crutches and shit. So I know I'm a pill right now and I'm not working out. This is like a perfect storm for me just to be an asshole, right? So I already know I'm that. And I'm going somewhere with Sal. Sal and I are the worst with directions, itinerary shit, all that stuff.
Yeah.
Like we rely heavily on Doug or Justin to kind of carry the load in that. And so we're by ourselves. And then you factor in, I'm fucking crippled.
You're immobile, yeah.
Yeah, and I'm thinking to myself, I told Katrina, I'm like, you know, I'm really nervous that Sal and I might get at each other because, and I know I'm like trying to tell her that I know that I'll be irritable. I know this is not his strength. But I tell you what, man, it was not at all like that. We had an incredible time and I was really, really, I was impressed.
Good thinking.
With the way he did. He really took care of me. Every time we went somewhere, did something, he always thought about like me not being able to carry things and getting it for me and opening. And I was like, and I don't like that too, as it is. I hate being disabled and feeling like you rely on somebody. And I didn't feel like I had to keep asking him like, hey bro, could you come help me zip up my pants? I can't do that. Like he was right there right away. Like right away, I'd get out of off that toilet. He would be right there to pick up my drawers and everything like that.
Wow. You went too far, man.
Too far. He wiped his ass and everything.
Just a little.
So he's pushing me in the wheelchair.
He tried
right?
to get me to do that. I'm like, listen, your hands work, bro. Right.
We're pushing him in the wheelchair, and so I have to hold his big fucking, you know, 16 by 24 or whatever photo drawing of him.
Yes.
Of me.
Finally connected. Yes. Me and Adam have had ours hanging in our house.
And dude, a bar boy, figment of your imagination.
He does awesome work.
Figment_of_imagination is his Instagram to look up how fucking talented this guy is. All of us have had random people do some cool graphic art and shit like of us before. Hands down, this is something that is like his talent.
It's art.
Yeah, no, it's next level talented. But it's funny because Sal is like, he doesn't do very well with this. He's like, dude, what am I going to do with this? I can't put it up in my room. Like,
makes you uncomfortable.
I was like, give that shit to me. I got it. So we're going through the airport and I'm like, I'm posting it up on my leg. You know, he's pushing me and I'm like, people are like looking at us.
See, huh? This guy?
Yeah,
right here. That's him.
I put it on the plane.
That's this guy.
I seatbelt it in. He's trying to turn it around so he doesn't look so narcissistic, right? Carrying a fucking, and I can't carry shit, right? When we're walking. So he's got to carry the photo himself and he like turns it so people can't see what it is.
I'm like, turning it
like, bro, it's a beautiful photo. Show that shit off, like calling it out of the airport and everything like that. I asked the lady, dude, I pick it up in the airplane, I'm showing it around. Hey, dude, where do I gotta put this? I'm like, is it okay on my lap? And I was thinking, he's all turning red.
It's embarrassing.
Yeah, it was fucking great.
It's embarrassing.
Dude. Fucking great, man.
Yeah.
Really embarrassing.
I wanted to go just
but
for
it's,
that.
I mean, it's an awesome, awesome, awesome sketch. It's just, you know, it's like, I feel like Mr. fucking Perfect from the WWE. Remember him?
Oh, yeah.
Look at me. You know, I got this picture of myself when I was shredded.
Totally.
Even worse, as we're going through the security check at the airport.
You gotta put it through the thing.
I forgot it there.
Yeah.
We walk all the way up. We walk all the way up and Adam's like, where's your picture? I'm like, fuck. So I walk all the way back.
It.
And they're waiting for me. They're all waiting for me.
Good job.
They all knew. They all look at me like, we got your picture.
We see you.
He drew it of himself. Yeah. It's like I was telling him, he drew it of himself. It's a good picture, right?
Anyway. Dude, I'll tell you what,
self-portrait.
Man. I tell you what a great time at the expo. We didn't really pump it up or promote it that much. We didn't make a big deal about it, and we had a great turnout of fans showing up, people who were there.
Oh, that's rad.
Quite a few people saying they were there just to listen to us, which I think is really cool.
Yeah.
Just had great conversation. The second day we were there, we didn't even talk about intuitive eating. We were supposed to, but it was all of our fans. So we're like, you guys hear us talk about that.
Well, not only that, like, when we got there and we realized like the environment, here we are trying to talk like about intuitive eating, which to me, I think is a very, anybody I've ever explained that, what
it's
is
like
that?
An alien concept, especially there.
Right, right. Yeah. And I'm like, you know what? We probably didn't put a lot of really good thought into this being the topic that we're talking about in this arena, right? Because it was loud. You know, you got tits all over the place and people doing cartwheels and Lululemon pants all over the place.
A little different than paleo effects.
Stringers and shit everywhere. And then here we are like, listen to your body.
Yeah.
And that's how you know what I'm saying? So
your tummy will teach you things.
The second day, you know, Sal and I agreed, like, you know what? Let's just fucking go out there. We'll tell people we're going to hook them up with the guide. And so they still feel like they get that information. We're going to take care of everybody. But then let's fucking do a Q&A and let's just answer questions for people. And probably like the first two questions kind of surface questions, you know, people asking. And then about the third question or so, people start asking like the controversy stuff.
Yeah.
And you could tell the first guy
starts some drama.
Oh yeah.
But
the first guy that asked the question, you could tell he's a listener and he knew what he was asking, like setting it up. And you could tell he was like, are they going to like really answer this? Or are they going to
see how PC they are?
Bro, we did
came after it, man.
For about 20 minutes, they're asking us all these questions and we're talking shit about 99% of the supplements out there in the fucking heart of the beast.
Yes.
We are surrounded. We are surrounded by supplement companies, and our mics are loud, and me and Adam project our voices anyway.
Oh, so good.
So we're just talking about how pre-workouts were, it was totally invented. It's bullshit. And, and I know, and I can tell people who were walking around all of a sudden stopped and kind of listening to us.
Was Shreds there?
It was.
No.
Actually, Joey Swole was.
So yeah, Joey Swole.
Did you guys talk to him?
No, he was on a.
I want to talk to him.
He was on a panel with Mike O'Hearn, Joey Swole, and then who was the other one? That
a panel?
Yes, dude.
What the fuck were they talking about?
I don't know, bro. We didn't hear him, but I saw a picture of him. I think so. We just talked to. We got interviewed by the girls. Shout out to the girls at 30 something. Great girls, great podcast. And they
was it almost 30? Is that the name of the
podcast? Is that what I said?
Yeah, you said
almost
30 something.
Oh, sorry, almost 30. Is their podcast, and very similar flavor to my. I flew over there. I was listening to some of their episodes so I can get kind of a feel of the two girls. And I was like, oh shit! I was telling Sal, these girls, they're sponsored by a dildo company. They're like, it's a
sex toy company.
They're banter. Same difference.
They make more than dildos.
Same fucking difference, right? So that same
pocket pussies too.
Yeah.
So let's get this straight.
Right. Yeah. But no, they were really cool. We brought up actually. I think we talked about Shreds for a minute, and I was asking them. They said, "Oh no, it's completely over. Like it's done. Like the company doesn't exist anymore." And they, I told them. I said,
"You're dead."
Because they'd only been listening to the show, I think, for the last year or so. I said, a lot of people don't know unless you've been a diehard fan or been listening since day one, or you've gone back and actually listened to all 600 episodes. But we were the first motherfuckers to call out Shreds. And I told the girls on the show, I said, listen, it wasn't like we were trying to hurt the business or call them out. It was just, our message was anti what they were a perfect example.
Anti-douchebaggery.
Well, they were a perfect example.
Thanks, Justin.
Yeah. They were a perfect example of what we were talking about. Like, this is the way you've been marketed to for so many years, and we're trying to be the change of that. And so we used them as an example a lot early on in when Mind Pump first started, and they were like, oh, blown away. They didn't know that. I was like, yeah, go back and listen to some of it. It's pretty funny. So to see where they're at now is hilarious. But what's even more hilarious is we get there, right? So they had it at their house is where they're at. We roll up to their place.
You fucker.
We're not even there but 5 minutes, right? We're just in there talking.
Yeah.
This dude goes takes a fucking shit in her bathroom, dude.
He shit in a girl's house.
Bro, he shit in a girl's house.
Wow.
Within 5 minutes we were there.
Bold move, Sal.
No, it wasn't even 5 minutes.
Thank God they had like
as soon as we got there.
Thank God they had like the candles lit and shit going on in the house.
Here's what happened.
Bro, you could have clogged the toilet.
No, right. No.
Then what?
Here's what happened. We get there and the whole place it's super girled out. So it's like
it's curled out.
It's scents. Yeah. There's just
it was like too much, so you had to shit. Right, you had to man it up.
It was just sense everywhere. It's like candles burning. There's like, you know, it just smells
fluffy
like
pillows, yeah, and white walls.
Oh, it yeah smells really nice. Nice yeah ambiance in there. Totally chicked out. So we go in there.
Yes, you had to fuck it up.
And this is what happened. Here's a true story. And you know, maybe the girls are listening right now. I apologize.
They're like, what are these streaks?
Here, I'm just going to keep it real.
It's official now. I'm hashtagging all your fucking photos. Shitbreak, bro. You have now taken
it. No,
bro. Shitbreak it. No.
We walk in. We walk in, and you ever have the moment where you're like, oh, shit, I got to fart.
Yeah.
And then you start to proceed to allow yourself to fart, but then you quickly realize.
It's a little wet.
There's more to come.
Yeah. You quickly realize you got to shut the door because there's more. Yeah. There's something there. And I'm thinking to myself, like, fuck, like, this is the process that goes through my head. And I know every person has gone through this, so fuck you if you're making fun of me. Everybody's gone through. I'm thinking to myself, like, I'm trying to calculate, how long is the podcast going to be? How long will it take getting the Uber back? Will I make it?
If I get excited, you know.
Yeah, will I be able to make it? Or is this one of those situations, like, I want to have a good podcast. I want to have a clear conscience. I want to, like, clear my mind.
And my asshole.
So I go in their bathroom, and I was fast, dude. That's why I didn't even know if I shit. I went fast.
I didn't know you did. I actually had no idea.
That's right.
It wasn't until...
I don't think they know until now, asshole. Well,
and thank God you have a great fucking co-host with you that could carry the conversation that when we just first met and just kind of distract them for 5 minutes while
like
you're
right
in
there. Right when you met, you're like, okay, where's your bathroom?
Well, no, so I go in the bathroom, and there's already candles that are lit in there. And
I think you did an upper decker.
They have bathrooms. No.
You did an upper decker?
No. That'd be terrible.
Uncalled for.
How funny would that be if I did that? Like the rivals, you know what I mean? Thanks for having us on your podcast. Yeah. Boom. No.
Good luck with this.
But anyway, the reason why. So here's the deal. Adam's angry, Justin.
Why am I angry?
Well, you're a very self-aware person, but it was a major ego hit.
What?
When we got to the expo.
Why?
So we walk into the expo.
Oh God! Yes. Listen,
you mentioned this on text. I want to hear about this.
This is a true story. Yeah. We walk as soon
dude,
as we
dude, he
walk
was
in,
glowing after
no,
this.
No, I wasn't.
Yeah, you
no,
was.
I wasn't.
All right,
I was sad. How sad?
Sad liar.
For you.
I was like, he can't take any more. We walk in. And the first person, so we're expecting maybe someone's going to recognize us. Who knows? Whatever. We don't care. We're walking in.
Yeah.
And this young lady walks in and she's like, oh my God, I love your show. I love listening to your show. You have the best podcast. And she goes on and on and on. And she goes, oh my God, can I take a picture? And we're like, yeah, absolutely. So she gives her phone to Adam.
No, that was the second time. Yes.
And she stands next to me.
What the hell?
So it's just me and her taking a picture.
When she was,
I didn't say anything for like
5 minutes.
The whole
time she was talking about she was saying your show, and she was like talking to Sal, and I'm standing right there next to him in my crutches, right? And I'm smiling and nodding my head, like, you know, but I can tell that the way she's talking about the show, she's talking to it and referencing it like as if it's Sal's show, and I'm just kind of standing there.
No, I don't think she recognized you.
Stefano Hour.
You know what? I hope she's listening because what you did—you actually gave your phone to Adam to take the picture with me. That wasn't just some random dude. That was pretty. It was pretty good.
That's epic.
It was a good time.
It was. That's how we started too. That was like I believe that was the first person to take a photo, right?
It was the very first.
Yeah,
person.
The very first. Some other dude was yelling "Mind Pump" across the way when we were crutching up. But once we got in, that was the very first person that walked up.
Hilarious.
I thought this is gonna be one of those trips, huh?
Yeah. Fantastic. Shout out to Nina for setting up the whole thing and the cauliflower foods people. We shared a booth with them. They were handing out
right.
Oh, the girls were there.
They were there.
Packed.
Yeah.
Bro.
I mean,
it's a great product.
Iza Amazing. I don't even know. I know that's not your real name, but we love you.
Yeah.
She came in. Shout out to her. She's one of our OG fans. Shout out to Kira. She's another one of our fans. Might be blogging for us. Yeah. So we saw a lot of cool people out there. Come say hi. And I think next time we do it, I think we should like really let people know ahead of time and do something cool.
Yeah.
And
next time we're just giving away some shirts, bro.
I might actually be there. You know, you guys.
By the way.
Of course, everybody. By the way. I was talking shit, dude. First day.
Bro, more than that. At least 10 people. Where's Justin? And then we tell him, oh, Justin's, you know,
he's too cool for this.
Yeah, we're like, oh, you know, he's...
He's my favorite.
Yeah.
He's my favorite.
Justin's just my favorite one. They're just saying
that because it's a friend. You know, cool, no picture for you.
Yeah, cool.
Move along, bitch. Cool.
Peace. There's people waiting for me.
And you can DM Justin.
Yeah. He's my favorite one. Oh, okay. Oh, really? Thanks.
Yeah.
Go fuck yourself.
Yeah. I appreciate you fans. I'm sorry I wasn't there. I'll be there for you next
You're like
time.
The elusive member of the band.
Yeah, you know, like I'm pretty cool. So, you know, I'll be there one of these times.
So I was fucking with Sal on the flight back, right? At first I was fucking with him with the picture and stuff like that, having a good old time. And then we have this lady sit between us. She's 60 years old. And
awesome lady.
Yeah, very, very cool. We had a great, we talked the whole flight and had a great conversation. You could tell very intelligent. And the way, and when she said she listened to podcasts, like, oh, what podcast? And she goes, oh, political podcasts. And I was like, oh.
Ooh, interesting.
And I look over at Sal and I just kind of like raise my eyebrows because I know he's the politics guy, right? So, and she is, you can tell that she's got like a Berkeley background. You know, she's rocking the Tivas, you know. So she's you know, she doesn't
she doesn't look
superficial. She looks, I mean, she definitely,
she's a hardcore old school super liberal,
very earthy.
No, but like a hardcore super liberal back when, you know, they were the ones protesting for free
and
speech
openly and admitted too. She was, she was about it, man. And she, and again, you
so
know,
Adam's trying to get into politics talk with her. I'm like, what are you doing, bro?
Oh, you guys should talk.
I'm like, we're sitting on a plane.
It was so great to see. You know what's funny about him when it comes of politics with things like that, what I've picked up on Sal, and this is what makes him so great at it, is that he doesn't look to pick fights in that arena. He would rather somebody pick a fight with him and then they get schooled, right? And then he circles back around. But he's never looking to...
No, you're not trying to be a bully. You're
to the point
to justify
where
points.
I keep trying to get him to talk about it, and he's like, you know, totally avoiding it, being super PC about his political views. He's not sharing them whatsoever. He's like, yeah, you know, I don't really subscribe to this. And he's just like, he's being very vague about
it. And it's not that I'm a hardcore conservative, because I'm not that either.
No, but you're not.
What I do is I try to sit, when I talk to somebody who's who really identifies with a particular ideology in politics.
You got to tiptoe around a
little bit. Not even tiptoe. I just try and find commonalities. Because I do have, first of all, she's an old school liberal from Berkeley. She's probably pro free speech, very much pro free speech.
Pro cannabis. So we hit it off there.
So nice. I know we can talk about that stuff and find. So anyway, Adam was trying really hard to get.
That's funny.
He was trying to see how I maneuver that.
But it was. It was actually maneuvered very well. We ended up making a great friend on the plane. Her son is into photography and editing. He's 20, nice. Same age as us, and he's into health and fitness. So, passed our number along, and so maybe we'll get a chance to meet
you. Got a girl's phone number.
Yeah, got a girl's.
Say what?
You know, what's funny, though, is we were, you know, talking about this.
Throwing digits your way.
So Adam's doing, you know, his whole, like, he's doing his presentation, right? My, you know, mind pump, and this is what we do. And we're saying, oh, dude. Dude, have you? I'm sure you've heard this, Justin.
I have.
He did this to every fucking Uber driver and taxi driver. Yeah. All they have
we're
to do
the
is
number
be like,
one fitness podcast.
Yeah. What do you guys? Yeah. What do you
on
so
iTunes?
So what do you guys do? And I'm like, all right, here we go. 20-minute, you know, presentation.
Yeah.
So he's doing this to this lady. Oh, we do media. And that's what we talk. We like to merge health and wellness with fitness, and
we're gonna be bigger than Netflix.
Yeah. Fitness industry preys on
your
fitness industry preys on your insecurities, and you know, it's about loving your body. And it's like this long presentation in Prezo about fitness and health. And doing this whole thing, and
did we not win her over?
And I, you know, I love it. But what's funny is she's like, "Wow, I'm going to check out your podcast." And so I'm like, "Oh, you know, that's cool." Then she's talking about the podcast she listens to, and she's like, "I really like this one podcast, but I really hate the beginning of it because." And she's talking about this political podcast because they just cuss all the time, and they're really vulgar,
they're really inappropriate.
She's like, "You don't need to do that to make your point. That's so stupid when people do." And I'm laughing, and
so
I'm,
juvenile.
Yeah, because Adam already sold the fuck out of Mind Pump, so I'm laughing. And I'm looking at her, I'm like, well...
This is where we get those 2-star reviews.
Like, you may not want to listen to my husband. Or fast forward the first 30 minutes, because we get pretty bad, too.
But then I told her, I said, you know, the cool part is we did have a lot of people, just like yourself, who gave us that feedback as we grew.
You maneuvered that well, because I was expecting you to say something. I thought you were going to say something like, yeah, our older fans don't like
that. No.
You've done that before.
No, I said we had a lot of intelligent fans like yourself that are there for the science and the information. They don't like the banter before, and you know, so what we figured out is, but we have another half of our audience, literally it's almost an even split of people that don't give a shit about the science, but then enjoy the banter and conversation early, right? So, you know, we came up with this formula where the beginning of every show, we kind of tell you that, hey, the first 23 minutes of the episode, Sal, Adam, and Justin get into talks like this. And then if you want to just get to the science, you can fast forward. She's like, oh, that's really cool.
Yeah.
So,
really cool.
She might not ever listen to this part right now. So.
Yeah. So, you'll never know.
You know what else was cool is Connor Murphy, our buddy Connor.
Hey, Connor.
Shout out to our boy.
He's a YouTube.
Sensation.
Celebrity, right?
Phenom. YouTube's,
yeah, the dude's
2
videos
million get, subscribers. I think,
is it 2 million?
More?
Or
it's
million?
Over 2 million.
It's over a million for sure.
Yeah, no, he's over 2.
He takes his shirt off and millions of views happen.
Yes. Yeah. And he, you know, we obviously interviewed him a while ago and talked with him. And smart kid, good looking kid, smart kid, a lot of potential. And he comes up to us after we finish our talk. And this guy, he's a legit fan of the show. He's actually listened to over 100 episodes, which I like that because there's a lot of egos in the media, especially the what we know, right, which is the digital media world, mm-hmm. where if you're really big, you don't necessarily listen to this thing over here or watch this thing over there because you're doing your own thing or whatever. Mm-hmm. But to have someone like him come up and be like a legit, like really love the show, he's listened to over 100 episodes, really fucking cool, man.
No,
and change some of his views on fitness. Very is really cool. And then there were people coming up to us telling us, like getting emotional, talking about how a lot of what we talk about has impacted them for the better. Mm-hmm. And then we come in today and read that letter. We got a letter from one of our fans. Who,
wow. Yeah. That hit me in the feels, man. Hard.
Dude.
I think we should have Doug read it, man.
Yeah, you think so? I can't even listen to it. It was very emotional. But a gentleman who, you know, fought addiction and depression, and we, I guess, listening to our show helped him throughout that. And big shout out to that guy, man. He sent us a bottle of, what was that? Bottle of
whiskey.
Whiskey.
Yeah.
Yeah. Rye, bourbon.
Bourbon. There you go. Yeah,
that was really cool. Man, I tell you what, this trip definitely, I think the most exciting part about it for me was to realize that, you know what, we've been in our own little world over here and working on our own media shit and busy, but I think it's really important that we get to these conventions and we get out there and we... And
sounds
we,
like it, yeah.
Yeah.
Until they kick us
face
out.
Face to face.
Because I told Sal, I'm not going to lie, man. I was telling him when we were there, I was like, you know what is it? Why did I not care too much about promoting it and getting people there? And I said, you know, if I'm being honest with myself, there was probably this bit of insecurity that, you know, how what a douchebag I'm going to feel like if I tell all these people to come through here and we hype it up on the show like crazy, and then there's like five or ten people out
in the corner booth,
right, and one of them's my cousin, right? Twitter, so like I probably there was a part of me that felt that way, but to see the turnout with us not even really talking about it and realize like, wow, okay, we definitely have some people. Because, dude, it's intimidating when you think about our message and going in there. I mean, we are outnumbered, not by a few, but by thousands inside this place.
It's completely against the grain in there.
Right, you know, so if we're going to go into enemy territory like that, talking shit about what these guys are all making their money on, I think it would feel good to have this big group of Mind Pump fans. So I think we'll...
Oh, I want to take it over.
Yeah, I think we're going to put some actually energy and money and time into the next one, and we're gonna make it just a fucking cool ass giving away shirts and sunglasses.
Giving shit away.
Bring a cannon.
Yeah, giving shit away, doing some live Q&A type stuff, man, and just having a good time and getting a chance to talk to people. We need to do more of that. I feel like we don't get out. We spend so much time in here creating content. We don't get out there and touch people.
Yeah,
so.
For people who were asking like, where's Justin? Like Justin was, you were back here getting.
Yeah.
Finishing up.
Trying to be productive, man.
Our next new program that'll be coming out, which is fucking awesome. And you were here. You guys, I mean, you guys hammered it out.
Mm-hmm. All day long.
In a day, right?
Yeah, you also knocked out the shirts, right? So, you know, a lot of people may not know this. One of the Mind Pump team New Year's resolution is to put a little bit more energy into the apparel line and start to grow that. And so as in a commitment to that, you know, Justin's kind of taken hold of that with the designers, and you know, we're going to try and release a new piece every week this year. So that starts up pretty soon here. Yeah.
So I have a bunch of designs in the hopper, and I just want to make sure this is nice and consistent, and you guys can kind of look forward to that. Like it's a new week, and we're going to go ahead and try and start this launch sequence, and
we're doing
get
them
these
all
things out to you guys,
and we're doing them all limited.
Limited edition.
So we'll come out with X amount.
Yeah, and if you guys really, really like a design or a print, I really want the feedback, and I want you guys involved with this. So obviously this is, you know.
Oh, the first one's dope. I've already saw the first one. The first one's cool. I love that you went the podcast hard angle. And so that's,
I had to throw that one in there. I thought that was kind of a cool tagline.
That's a great one to kick off
the
year.
We should send a copy of one, a shirt of one of those to all of our podcasting friends because of what it says.
Yeah. No, absolutely. Yeah. I already have that planned. That's going to happen.
I'm excited about that. Yeah.
That's awesome. The other thing that was pretty fascinating was, because really the last time we were out and really talking to people about podcasts was, well, we did Paleo Effects, and then before that had been a while. And I used to hear relatively regularly when I would ask people if they listen to podcasts that they didn't even know what a podcast was. I don't get that anymore. Everybody listens to podcasts.
Yeah, it's become really more mainstream growing. For sure.
It's really growing.
Yeah, that's great.
I think I gotta start changing the way I ask people because I still have that. Do you know what a podcast? Before I even tell them what we do,
there's
go,
a button on your phone,
right? Do you know what a podcast is? Yeah. But more and more people now, I ask that question to, and they're like, "Yeah, yeah, no, I listen to them." Oh, cool, you do.
I wonder if Spotify has helped with that too, because now like you can actually find it on.
If it hasn't, I know it will eventually, because you see what's going on our forum, and people are saying like, "Man, Spotify is so much easier for me."
I'm sorry, but I love it.
Yeah, I'm listening.
That's what I use every time now.
Do you use it to listen to our
bro?
Show?
It's just it's faster.
Like it connects.
iTunes is, it connects right away. You can see the episodes easier on Spotify that way, the display.
Yeah.
I mean,
Some of my favorites haven't.
I don't know if that's a good thing for us to be telling the audience that because it'll probably drive our iTunes numbers down and then we'll rank lower. Right? But to be honest, man,
our Lipson numbers will still be the same. So it's all good.
Yeah, Lipson will be the same. But I mean, as far as our ranking on iTunes, it could be counterproductive.
I still use
the
iTunes ones. So but I haven't tried the Spotify version yet.
Yeah. But I'm also a Spotify user too.
What I see.
Yeah, me too.
I see Spotify getting into the podcasting world or having podcasts is less about them trying to boost it up and more about them recognizing that this is a growing market. And it's going to just cause competition because for sure, Apple is a fucking monster. Mm-hmm. They're a beast. And you know, once they see that, oh shit, this market's starting to do whatever.
They'll just put
more money in and bolster it. Absolutely.
Yeah. No, I believe that. I just hope it doesn't go bad for us when it does happen because right now we have a lot of freedom with what we say on the podcast, how it works. Like there's we don't have a lot of rules that
that's why I like that we're, on other platforms too. So
right. That's right.
Super dependent on one.
It's pretty decentralized. So it's different than YouTube where YouTube is like only show and tell.
I know, but YouTube was like that also.
Restrictive
now.
Yeah.
They are.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I'm saying that. I'm saying that that's
scary,
the fear is that does iTunes go that direction too?
We saw them launch their TV now this year, right? Is that crazy?
Did you guys see the shit with Logan Paul right now?
What happened with that? He posted like a dead body.
Did you watch
something?
It?
No.
So the kid goes to, man, he is getting the fucking heat right now.
Yeah, he's getting smashed.
I almost feel like there's people that are like intentionally like trying to really, I mean, hit the video.
Yeah.
Clips of the video have millions of views. So other people are picking back on so much pull this kid has. It's crazy to me.
Wow.
That, think about that. His pull is so big that
you make a review video of his video.
Yes, you make a review video of his video and you get millions of views. That's fucking insane to me, right? So anyways, that's beside the point.
Yeah.
He did this video. He went to, was it Japan? Japan, there's a famous forest.
Oh, the suicide forest.
The suicide forest.
How'd you know about that?
I've just known about it.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, so I've never heard of it before, and I guess it's a famous place where a lot of people commit suicide.
Yeah.
And he went, and I guess his intentions were to go there, make a funny documentary.
Just to make it about the ghosts, and it's spooky and scary.
How do you make it funny?
Not funny, but more about the spookiness and the scariness of it.
Oh, I see.
Right.
But they actually ran into a dead body.
Oh, shit.
And they were calling the cops, and he was really scared about it. And so I don't necessarily think the mistake he made was putting the video on.
Right, like releasing it
because you could tell they're like, oh fuck, we need to call the cops.
Yeah, that
was
a mistake.
But him putting it on was kind of a mistake because it comes across as self promotion versus like if he just sent it to a news agency and had the news agency.
Yeah,
I don't know.
And then they release it.
Yeah. So people
went
after him.
Which is stupid by him because if the desired outcome was to still get traffic from it, he could have done the right thing and he still would have got it.
Yeah.
Because if you would have dropped that to a news anchor, of course the news people would have told the story. YouTube star Logan Paul does this. And then he probably could have done a follow-up video talking all about
it. That's right.
And he probably could have saved his image.
It's touchy because it's hard to understand when you're in that world where you're showing people everything and everything
you
do.
So transparent.
Yeah. And everybody loves what you do. Like, he was genuinely, I feel like they were genuinely in the video like, oh shit, what's going on here? I don't think they planned it, but I think a lot of people said, he was sensationalizing it, taking advantage of it.
Right.
Plus, he's also gotten busted in the past for kind of being a little racist in his videos and stuff.
No, that's his little brother, I think, that got nailed for that.
Yeah, or him making, like he was in Japan kind of making fun of the culture. And, the everybody's super sensitive about that stuff now, too. So, yeah, he's getting fucking taken down. Hmm. That's the thing that's crazy about this new social media celebrity is that you can rise very quickly, but you can fall just as fast, if not faster, than anything I've ever seen because they don't have like publicists and stuff like the other people did, you know, on TV and stuff.
Oh, and people, the bigger you are, the more targets you have on your back, man. I tell you what, like, I mean, it was one of the things that we talked about when we first started this, like, no matter what, like, listen, the transparency thing is so important because eventually someone's going to hate and find stuff out. So if you put something out there, I doubt you're going to put something out there that I haven't fucking talked about. Like, I haven't put out about myself already. So, I think a lot of that part of our motivation was knowing that and thinking like that, you know, this is partially, not only are we being honest and sharing, but then we're also protecting ourselves that, listen, asshole, I already said that about me.
So brought that up.
You're not
covered it.
You're right. You're not uncovering anything big about me. I've already admitted to that or said that. So, yeah, it's a scary place to be for somebody when you get that much power. That
so
much
many
control.
Eyes on him. Yeah.
Right. It'll be interesting to see how he handles and navigates that.
Let's bring on the media bird.
Let's go, bird.
Bring it on.
This Quah is brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
First up is Cody Phillips, 1791. I recently injured my Achilles tendon, and it sucks because I'm scared to do anything because I don't want to tear it. I was wondering what Adam has been doing as far as recovery and aiding the healing process.
Oh, shit. Well, injured and torn is probably a different scenario here, so I don't know how bad this guy did his Achilles. I'm in a fucking boot for the next 6 to 8 weeks, so there's not a lot of rehabbing going on. But I'll tell you what the doctor and I talked about. One of the things he was most impressed about when I got there was how much the inflammation was down for such a bad injury already. But that was just me knowing that as soon as it happened, I literally went home, elevated it, and I have a back from my knee surgery. I had got a what are those called? The normatic ice machines?
Oh, the one that just keeps pumping cold
ice. That way you don't, you can just keep it on forever, right? So I strapped that on, wrapped it around my ankle and foot and up my calf and got it elevated and was just, I was living on the ice constantly and elevating. And that's helped that. And then I was kind of mobilizing it and doing like circles and the alphabet with my foot to just kind of get it used
just
to
just doing what you can, basically.
Yeah, doing what I can. But actually the doctor told me to stop doing that and that because there is so much damage there that he wants to keep it in a fixed position to help speed up the scar tissue buildup.
I was going to say, that's usually the protocol, right, is they get you a certain like angle of the boot and then they slowly kind of like change the angle.
Yeah, so I have
month
a...
month by month.
Exactly. I have a... I think we started with like a 30-degree plantar flexion in the heel and there's these little risers that are about a quarter inch and then he's just slowly chipping them off. But I'm also, you know, here's a time where, okay, great, we got a sponsor, Organifi, that carries turmeric. I don't really use turmeric that much on a regular basis, but I am now because of
anti-inflammatory.
Right, it's an anti-inflammatory. So that, and we now have the gold juice. So now that I have those, I'll start using that because it tastes amazing. It's even better than doing like the pill form. So, you know, I'll be doing that. So right now there's not a lot that I'm doing, but I will, just so this guy knows, I'm going to document this process. I will be heading over to see Brink. And we'll be doing the red light therapy on it. We'll be getting into the cryo on it and laser stuff. Like, so I will be doing some things to treat it. And then I'm not going to go to physical therapy. I'm going to do all my own rehab. And I can share some of the things that I start doing once that process happens. But right now I'm so freshly injured that there's not a lot of things that I'm doing right now that that's related to rehab. It's more about protecting it, letting the scar tissue build up and letting it heal.
So when I hear, I know I totally fully understand why doctors will say, don't move something at all. And I think part of it is rooted in the older mentality, or which dare I say is a little bit outdated, where if you have something that's injured acutely, that you shouldn't touch it and you shouldn't move it at all, because if you do, then it's going to slow down the healing process. I think part of that comes from the average person when they come in with an injury and you tell them, God forbid you tell them to move a little bit, they don't understand how much to move or how far to push or ranges of motion. Right. And so they tend to re-injure themselves or cause more problems. Now, in the case of someone like you, who, you know, you know your body. You've been in fitness for a long time. You understand correctional exercise. You understand your limits. You know what good and bad pain is far more than the average person. The studies will show that movement facilitates and accelerates healing, even in acute injuries. Yeah. Now, the key is knowing how much movement, right? And how, so depending on the acute, that how acute the injury is.
Yeah, where your threshold is there.
Right. So you sitting there moving your foot around, not pushing it to the edges, but just moving it around, it's only going to accelerate healing. And the studies are now supporting this. The other thing is this. Here's a lot of people talk about how tough it is to heal from an injury, but what a lot of people don't talk about is after the injury is healed, you are now in a secondary situation. And I believe that secondary situation is the cause of most of the chronic problems that people have after an injury. It's not the injury itself. Like, I break my leg, I tear my Achilles partially, I have a partial tear in my pec, whatever, and I immobilize it and I let it heal. And then when I go to move and stuff, I've got poor recruitment patterns and tightness that's now developed as a result. For example, we'll talk about your Achilles. Your foot now is fixed in this, you know, almost 90 degree angle, maybe not quite 90 degrees, right? They have it, they put a slight heel on it.
Yeah, so it's about a 30 degree plantar.
30, okay, so 30 degree plantar. Your calf, your soleus, your all the muscles that support the ankle, your tibialis muscle are frozen. If you were to put your foot completely frozen in that position, they eventually become frozen in that position. Your central nervous system now becomes uncomfortable with lengthening or shortening out of that position, because it you're stuck.
It creates governing system around that.
Around that. Yeah. So I think the best thing you could do, if you know what you're fucking doing, which I think Adam does for sure, is move it a little bit and then do some massage on the affected muscles, not on the injury. And the reason why I say doing massage is because when you press on a muscle and improve on what's called the pliability, studies will show that does improve or at least contribute to some flexibility. It's not quite as good as stretching when you're trying to get range of motion, but it is causing the CNS to feel stuff that's happening and prevent so much tightening. So I would say massage the muscles that may be affected, as long as you're not near the injury or hurting yourself. So like in this case, calf massage, soleus massage, maybe your tibialis massage, and then very slight movement or just activating the muscle and flexing the muscle a little bit, that'll make you heal faster. Because the old model of like, don't move, leave it, I think has caused, definitely it's the safe route because you're not going to re-hurt it.
Right.
But it caused a lot. I mean, how many times have you guys had clients who came to you who are like, oh, I had shoulder surgery, you know, 4 years ago. Yeah. And they still have like terrible dysfunction in their shoulder.
Yeah, well, that's where I think there's less. I think right now going through the first like 4 weeks of this injury and hoping that we get the scar tissue to build up as fast as possible is one thing. And then I think the rehab process is a whole nother thing, because that to me is where I think that's where the biggest mistake is. I think the biggest mistake is not the...
Well, it's all part of the rehab process.
Yeah, but I don't think the not mobilizing it as much when the injury first occurs is as detrimental as the way people rehab, in my opinion. In my opinion, the biggest mistakes are made during the rehab protocol and the lack of attention to detail when you're getting back to your movements, because you have been frozen in this fixed position. I have no doubt in my mind that after I get done from having a boot on my foot for 6 to 8 weeks, that I have changed recruitment patterns. There will be this new learning curve.
Oh, dude, just watching you stand, because you've got an elevated foot that's higher than the other one, so now your hips have to shift. Right. It's affecting your back and all that. Yeah.
So, and I don't think in that 6 to 8 week time that, you know, if I didn't do enough mobilizing of the foot, I'm going to have set myself that far back. It's what I do going forward to me that where I think because what happens is just like what you're saying and the point you're trying to make is that a doctor
tell somebody that, and then they hear that, and they're like, well, my doc said don't move it, don't do anything about it. So not only do you not do it during the whole healing process, but even when it heals after that, you're still really careful not to move it.
You're naturally going to have to change your recruitment patterns because you're going to have to favor it for a while until you can actually apply, you know, that amount of force and pressure, like, substantially to it. So, you know, it's sort of somewhere in the middle where, you have to have a good knowledge of how to do that, and have a background in, like, knowing your thresholds, but obviously mobilizing will help to facilitate, you know, the recovery quicker.
Well, and I'll tell people when and how I do that right now, because I don't agree with, well, I don't now, especially after confirming with the doctor, because I was kind of, you know, mobilizing it more. And he was one who told me, like, no, I want you to be in a fixed position more to let it heal faster. And that is this, is that when I take the boot off and I ice, I bring down the inflammation. That already allows more range of motion because the inflammation comes down. And then I just do like these circles with my ankle, or when I go to bed and the boot is off and I'm laying in bed and stuff like that.
Has it gotten real swollen after you've done like a couple sessions like that?
No, because I do it post right after ice. So it's kind of like, so your icing is 20 on, 20 off type of deal, right? So I'll be like watching TV or something, ice, elevate, the inflammation comes down, I take it off, let it breathe for a little bit. While I'm letting it breathe, I'm kind of just doing these little movements, and just some of them are just like wiggling my toes. I just want to stay connected down there more than anything. Like me trying to push the range of motion
it's not a pressure thing. It's just the mobilization. Right.
And I think that's a good thing. I think you're only going to accelerate the healing process.
I think so too. It's also why I choose to be on crutches or walk on it too, opposed to, you've seen those little scooters. And I had people DM me like, oh, you should just do one of those scooters. They're awesome.
Oh, my God, they're terrible.
Yeah, no, and I'm like, no, that's even worse. Like, it's worse for me to use one of those scooters and really, like, you want to make sure, because atrophy is going to happen too. I'm not putting a lot of weight on it because I'm shifting more of my weight to the dominant side. So I'm already at a disadvantage there. I put it on a fucking scooter. Dude, I'm really going to send that signal.
The bottom line is when you have a hammer, everything's a fucking nail. Everything looks like a nail. And when you go to your surgeon and you have a problem, they are surgery. They understand that it's not malintent.
Oh, dude, before I went, so I don't know if I told you, or I shared this on air or not, but before I went, and so Dr. Brink was the one who hooked me up with the doctors, and I said, he hooked me up with an MRI somewhere, and then we went to another place to go see the doctor, and I said, orthopedic surgeon, and I said to Brink, I said, hey, listen, dude, in my experience, I know the doctors are always going to lean towards surgery because that's what their profession is. If you're an orthopedic surgeon, you went to fucking school to be badass at fucking doing surgery.
That's what you know.
Yeah, badass doing surgery. And so you, like you're saying, you look at everything like a nail that, listen, it's broken, I can fix it. And even if it's not fully broken, I can still do some good for it. Mm-hmm. And so they still recommend surgery. And so I told him, I said, I do not want to have surgery. It is
it's absolutely necessary.
Yes, unless a doctor says to me it's absolutely. And I knew that I still had some of the ligament there because I did have some movement there. So I knew it wasn't completely severed and gone. So I believe that, hey, there's definitely potential that I can rehab this myself and bring it back. So his doctor's telling me. So I know that Brink has kind of prefaced it already to him. So you could just tell by the way he's speaking to me, like, you know, so surgery's not necessary, but I do recommend it. He says, I recommend it because you have a lot of damage. He laid me on the table face down, and he did this test to show Katrina, and he went on my good calf and he went down and he like would squeeze my calf all the way down to my ankle.
Pulled your ankle.
Yeah. And you'd see my foot move, and he went to the left side and there's no movement, no response. Flip all the way down. And my foot just laying there like a fucking dead fin. And so he's like, you know, you definitely have a good amount of damage that's been done in there, and I would recommend surgery and this and that and this, and it would decrease the chances of you re-injuring it. So now if I'm a normal patient, I hear that.
You're scared.
I'm scared, mm-hmm. And I say, fuck yes. Yeah. But the response to that I tell people they should do, and what I did was said, well, what is the percentage?
Yeah, how substantial?
Yes, how substantial? If I have surgery, how much is that going to increase decrease the chances of me doing that? He says, maybe somewhere between 5-15%. I'm like, I'll fucking take my chances.
Of course.
Right? Yeah. 5-15% chances, knowing my abilities.
And that's what I mean. And that's what I mean. They're a hammer. Everything looks like a nail.
Shout out to the doctor. Dr. Murray was who the doctor was. And I
know
do
who
respect,
he is. He's a badass.
Yeah, no, he was.
I know who he is because my gym was in Los Gatos and I heard about him. and he's a badass orthopod.
Yeah.
But, you know, orthopods know, they don't know anything about rehab. They don't. They're not supposed to. They understand surgery, which is what you want them to know. You go get surgery, you want that dude or that girl or whatever to be awesome at it.
Right.
But they don't know rehab. They don't know any of that stuff. They understand surgery. They know pre-op, post-op, and that's pretty much it. So when you go in with the problem that they may have a solution to, their solution is going to be surgery. And this is part of the problem. Like, you know, I'll tell you what, man. Like I said, I've talked about this before, but I had a family member had cancer. She was terminal. We go to the oncologist, and the oncologist basically is like, okay, we can try this chemo regime. They didn't expect me to ask questions. And I'm like, okay, well, how much longer will this have her survive? Well, the literature shows that.
Yeah, first they say, well, we don't know.
Yeah, well, we don't know. But the literature, I don't know, maybe like maybe a few weeks to a month. And so that's important to fucking know, because if I'm fighting,
consider that,
dude, if I'm fighting quality terminal cancer and I'm going to be on this fucking hardcore chemo regime, and I may live another, you know, month, but I'm sick as hell and I'm just feeling like garbage, and, you know, maybe my quality of life is reducing, might not be worth it. Yeah. So it's important to know. So, you know, the question you asked, Adam, was perfect. Like, what are my chances of re-injuring it if I don't get, what are the increase of chances if I don't get surgery? 5 to 15%. Well, you know what that sounds like to me? That sounds like I know how to rehab really well. I understand correctional exercise. I think that's those are great statistics.
So do I. I think just simply knowing that, because I told him, I was very open too about the whole testosterone thing. I said, man, I had no idea until this happened that having low testosterone that I was at a higher risk. He says, well, yeah, absolutely. He says high or low testosterone will do it. So even high, he says, well, you are at a higher risk to have an Achilles injury, just like than being normal.
So. Yeah, really high testosterone, because your strength goes up so quickly in your muscles, your tendons.
It's the contrast there.
Your tendons and ligaments, they don't have time to catch
and
up.
That one I've always known, right? So I've always been aware of.
You're generating so much power.
Right. I've been aware of that. And I've seen that happen to many guys in the gym who tear a pec or something because they're doing steroids and they fucking are doing way more weight. Their muscles can handle it, but their ligaments and joints and tendons cannot.
They're usually just so like, whoa, this is happening, and then they just keep ramping it up without thinking about
it. Right. Yeah. No, I had a cousin who, you know, benching 400 pounds, you know, and just literally ripped his pec right off, man. It was just forever.
I saw a quad. I saw someone rip a quad
forever,
right off their patella.
But I
shoot up into the dude's hip. Fucking horrible.
For Cody's answer, I will document this. I will share this. As of right now, I'm sick right now too, so I haven't even got a chance to get back to like lifting my upper body and doing things like that in the gym. If those that follow me on Instagram know that my story's been a little weak lately, and that's just because I've been fucked up lately, and we've been traveling and a lot going on. But I will get to that, and I will definitely share that.
Next question is from The Hungry Trainer. Your thoughts on the resistance tubes and bands that a lot of girls are wearing around their thighs during their leg workouts these days?
That's hilarious.
So, first off, absolutely love resistance bands and tubes.
Oh, yeah.
They're fantastic.
Hip circles are great, man, for primers.
They're fantastic tools. And like all tools, if you use them right, they've got a great purpose. If you use them wrong, they're at best a waste of time. At worst, you can cause imbalances or lots of issues. Now, here's why I like tubes. I like bands and tubes because they're very versatile. And the type of resistance that they provide is very different from the resistance you'll get from a machine or from free weights. Mm-hmm. It's progressive resistance. Obviously, the further out you stretch a tube, the harder it gets. So it gives you that kind of ramp up, you know, feature that it's cool about
follows
them.
Your strength curve a little bit more specifically.
A little bit more. And it doesn't seem to cause nearly as much muscle damage. I've actually done full, heavy, heavy just tube workouts. And you just don't damage muscle and hammer your CNS like you do with free weights, which is a good thing because you can add them to workouts and still send somewhat of a muscle building signal.
Well, you understand what this guy is saying though, is saying how they're using it, right?
Yeah. They're using it wrong.
Yeah,
they're just like leaving it on there, thinking that their glutes are always going to be firing.
Yeah, well, they're typically putting around their knees and so that they have to kind of push.
I've seen girls do that with like leg press. They have it on, then they get up, then they squat, then they go to this, to that, to the other.
You got to explain though. Here's the deal: like there is a reason why you feel it. So I know there's girls
that are listening right now, like, I don't care what Mind Pump says. When I do that, my fucking ass gets sore
I get sore.
So, and a part of that is that's your glute med kicking in to keep the knees opened up. Mm-hmm. So when you do a leg press, you go to do a squat, and because you have a band on there, it forces you to activate your glute med before you even get into the squat. So before you even get into the squat, before you get into the leg press, you're already activating the glute med.
You're pushing your knees out.
You're pushing your knees out, and you have to do that because you have a band around it. So, and a lot of people, this is something that they have a problem with. One of the most common things that you see with someone who leg presses or squats is the caving in of the knees. And even some people that don't have it bad still have it slightly. And what that is the glute med is somewhat turned off in a sense. So they're not firing it properly. The beautiful part is if you actually learn to squat with good depth and good form and know that part of the cues are keep your knees from collapsing in, you squatting with some good weight and actually actively thinking about keeping your knees open will develop that glute med just like you want along the way.
I'll give you an example of when this would be a bad idea. And this is relatively rare. I'm going to use an extreme example because you see this sometimes in the regular population. But I've trained dancers. I've trained ballet dancers and classically trained dancers. And when you're a dancer, especially in ballet, you do a lot of hip abduction. This is where the leg goes out and separates from the body, where the legs go out from the body. So it's like abduction would be like that good girl, bad girl machine where you're pushing your knees out or whatever. Mm-hmm. Whenever I've trained dancers, their knees don't cave in. Their knees go out. And it turns into, everything we do turns into a sumo squat or a plie, where no matter, if I try to keep them pointing straight, the knees point out. It would be disastrous to put a band around this person's legs, because what you'd be doing is you would be making the imbalance.
You're exaggerating.
Way worse, where their feet want to turn out and knees want to turn out. So that's just an example of how just throwing bands around your knees because you're like, I feel this more in my butt, might not be a good idea. Bands are great for correction, and what you want to do is you want to add resistance towards the direction that you're weak in, so that you have to constantly keep, be mindful of that tension. The other thing you can do with bands is you can do them in between your workouts, like we talk about in our programs. MAPS Anabolic in particular, we recommend trigger sessions, and we recommend using bands for those trigger sessions because they're really effective in that context. But in this particular sense, I don't know about you guys, but I rarely see people using bands right in the gym.
Yeah, and even then, like, you're using an external trigger for that, right? You need that signal provided. After a while, you get dependent on that for you to fire, properly.
In order for it to fire.
In order for it to fire. You need a resistance, you got to just be mindful of, what you're teaching your body for all these different movements. And, is this coming intrinsically? Can I produce force on command and in the right direction with each one of these, compound movements? Or do I need assistance from some kind of external force?
Simple way to still use this more effectively, right, would be you could pre-exhaust the glute meds by doing some – tube walking, right? For example, tube walking is going to get the glute.
So now you woke them up.
Right. Woke them up. You feel what's being activated while you're doing it. And then you go into your squat or leg press movement. And while you're doing it, you're already actively thinking about that part of the glute while you do it. And it's going to help. I promise. Yeah. I think where I notice girls that feel this the most and get sore I got sore. So they've connected that to it's super effective are the ones that only squat down to about 90 degrees.
There you go.
They do these short little pumping squats and they have bands around their knees and they've been doing quad type of squatting for so long. Now all of a sudden they put a band around their knees.
They do fixed angles with a Smith machine and they don't actually stabilize any of their joints.
If you are a good squatter, let me tell you, if you're a girl trying to build your ass, if you are a good squatter, by meaning good range of motion, good form, and you focus on strength, you will build your ass better than any fucking fancy, glute thing. And that is including even like our boy Brett Contreras, who puts out the hip thrust and all that. That's all great. That's dandy. And those will help and those will help build you. But I'll tell you right now, if you don't squat properly and you only come down to 90 degrees and you stop there and the bands have been your answer to get more glute activation.
It is important that we got to say this though. If you do squat low, you got to have good control. Yeah. I just don't want a bunch of people hearing this.
You have to have tension in it.
Yeah, no, I don't want a bunch of people tension. I'm going to go all the way down.
No, you got to. Yeah. The point of being a great squatter is learning that you may not be capable of that right now. I was not a good squatter 2 years ago. I was not able to go all the way down. I consider myself a pretty good squatter now. I don't think I'm great by any means at all. And I'm definitely not somebody to be like, that guy's the squatter. But I for sure have addressed a lot of the issues that I had that kept me, that limited me from being a good squatter. And nothing has developed my legs and my butt more than just
being able to do that,
working. So put all your energy and effort. And
our butt builder bundle includes a modification in it where we program out how to get these things to fire properly so that when you do your squats and stuff, they actually work and go lower and you can activate the glutes and get everything to work the way it's supposed to.
Right, that's right. And all our bundles this month, we're hooking people up with a free shirt. So if you're already looking in this direction anyways, check out the butt builder bundle, get hooked up with a free tee too.
Gotcha.
Next question is from Andrea Malecki. What do you think about cycling different diets seasonally in a health-conscious but also experimental way? For example, high-fat keto bone broth diets in the winter, paleo in the fall, vegan in the spring, and carb cycling in the summer.
I love it, dude.
This is
I love it.
This is now there is some science to point that this might actually be a good strategy. Nothing specifically, but they do show that people who live in colder climates, for example, do in their native diets do tend to contain higher levels of certain fat soluble vitamins like vitamin D because, and they probably evolved to do this or it worked out that way because they're not getting a lot of sun. So like if you live in Greenland, you may eat a lot of these, you know, cod liver, these organ meats from these, you know, animals that are native there that tend to be very high in things like vitamin D where in the summer you just go out in the sun. I really think that this is a smart theory. Mm-hmm. I really do because
it follows the seasons. It just makes, a lot of sense.
One of the reasons why humans can eat so differently and get away with eating so differently. We were just, what was that video, Adam, you were seeing where that guy's like, I'm going to be eating just meat for the next year.
Oh, there's some guy right now that's a full 100. He's been a
carnivore.
He's been a carnivore.
He was on Joe Rogan. Yeah, I listened to that.
What was his name? Do you know his name?
I don't remember. He's a doctor. Yeah.
Yeah, this guy's been eating 100% meat for the last year.
Now, is that ideal long term? No. Can you get away with it? You probably could if you're healthy.
Our bodies are amazing.
The human body. Listen, we traveled.
Listen, I got away with eating 3 protein bars and 2 shakes every fucking day for fucking years.
Yeah, that's right.
For like 10 years, bro.
You didn't die.
Yeah, and I didn't die. So yeah, you could do.
Might not have been the best.
Yeah, right. You could do a lot of shit for a long time.
Well, I mean, we have a very non-specific diet, unlike a lot of animals. Some animals are very specific with what they eat. Like, you know, whales, they'll just eat plankton, and this particular animal will only eat this type of fruit. Humans were hunter-gatherers. We spread out all over the place. Sometimes it was freezing cold, and there was zero vegetation, zero fruits, and zero roots, and all we did was eat what we hunted. So we probably went carnivore for, you know, periods of time, or just got fish for periods of time. There was other times when, I'll tell you what, if you're a hunter-gatherer, and you're looking to hunt and you find a shit ton of fruits and vegetables and nuts and seeds, you ain't gonna hunt.
No.
Because it's right there. I don't need to chase it down.
You're
it's not dangerous.
Stuffing that in.
I'm just gonna eat this and chill because that's safe. So humans can do well on lots of different types of foods. And it's very likely that our diets cycle, not just likely, I bet money on it, that our diets cycled through the seasons because of what grew around us,
was available.
Absolutely.
Well, I know,
so this makes perfect sense.
I know Andrea is in our forum. I would love to see you do this and document it and share it. Here's the thing.
Wasn't she on that show?
Yeah.
With Steve Austin?
Yeah. So I think that...
She's a badass.
I think this is an awesome idea. It would be a fun experiment to do. It's something that I would love to do this. The part that I'm kind of realistic with is I know that that's a major commitment. That's a major commitment to stick to that in seasons. And
it's funny because the reason why it's a major commitment is because modern lifestyle
makes it too easy.
I can fucking eat whatever
I
want.
It makes it too easy to be one or the other, right? Like you might find out like you're going keto and you're like, man, this has just worked really good with my lifestyle. But you're like, oh shit, winter's over. Now I got to switch over to paleo. This is different now, right?
Yeah.
So the irony is that we evolved that this is the way we had to eat because that was all that was available. Mm-hmm. Where now, eating the way that we evolved actually would be really challenging.
New world problems.
Because we have so much of everything.
I would not be surprised if a diet book I would love to write one around
bro,
this.
Bro,
I'll tell you what.
Because if there's something that I... Okay.
That's got sales all over it. It's got all the freaking...
Oh, it's
like,
brilliant.
Yeah,
it's
the hooks and everything.
It is a brilliant, brilliant guide or book to write because we just talked about it at the convention. Someone asked, one of the questions that was asked to Sal and I was, well, what diet do you guys follow or how do you eat? And I said, you know, we don't subscribe to one diet, and we don't believe that anybody should subscribe to one diet unless you have a specific condition where one of them. You're right. Other than that, we should all be searching for all the different foods, and that when you follow a protocol,
yeah, because even what works best isn't always going
to
be the case,
right? Yeah. Exactly. So I think if I were to subscribe to a way of eating. Rotating in and out.
I kind of do that naturally, but I don't match the seasons. Andrea's brilliant, by the way she put this together. Because for sure in the winter, if you're eating what's around you, it's probably going to be high fat keto, you know, animal based. Paleo in the fall, vegan in the spring, and carb side. She's brilliant the way she put it together. I would not be surprised. In fact, I bet you I can find it in the next two seconds. There's probably a diet book.
I'm sure.
But it makes perfect sense.
In our intuitive guide, we actually kind of do this. We just don't lay it out for a year and say that. But in the intuitive guide, we have an examples of a paleo, of a vegan, what a day of eating looks like that. So if you don't have the intuitive guide, you could actually use that guide as a guide for you to follow a similar protocol as this. But I can't wait to hear if she's going to do this. I think it'd be awesome.
Next question is from Rosen Trained. If you could create a drinking game for listening to Mind Pump, what would the rules be?
Justin so picked this question,
right? I totally did. I think this would be so much fun.
It would be fun to do this. What would we...
It has to be around like one of our distinctive characteristics.
All right. I think every time Sal says, ladies and gentlemen, or a study,
there you go,
right? you have to take a drink.
Yeah. Obviously, every time I'm... say like or or I do that a million times.
Or pause in your story.
Pause, yeah.
Do I mess up enough words in a fucking episode that you could actually get smashed? Yeah, you get smashed. Every time I make up a word.
Every time you eat on the podcast.
How about every time we talk about Mind Pump in the third person?
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Like Mind Pump wants to do.
Do we do a lot of that?
Shot. My girlfriend points it out all the time. She's like, why does Mind Pump talk about Mind Pump all the time?
You know, well, it's a little bit hard too when you're referencing all three of you. It's easier to say Mind Pump than to go Doug, Justin, Sal, and me, you know, right?
Yeah.
So, or refer to every person.
We should tell the forum to create a drinking game.
I think that's what we need.
No, yeah. I think this would be done best by others who have listened and laughed and probably made fun of us.
You put it together, we'll promote it, and
I think when you hear.
I'll do it with you guys.
When you hear Doug laughing in the background, you have to take three shots.
Oh, yeah.
Because it doesn't happen too often, but when it does.
That's like a home run.
That's like a slam. A beer. Yeah, you could, now if someone put some dime into this, you could make it cool if you went like, okay, there's a drink for this, a shot for this, a beer chug for this.
Yeah, if I open up with a song, you know, you got to
do two shots. Yeah, this would be fun. Actually, if a forum member put this together, I would love to.
I don't want anybody getting too sick, though. You know what I mean? We gotta be careful about this.
That's why they need to put it together.
Did you guys ever play Century Club?
No.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So
yeah,
I played that. Century Club is
beer, shots of beer.
Right. Yeah. So this is actually kind of a cool drinking game. But I say this with caution. What you do is you make a cassette tape.
Make a mixtape.
Yeah.
It's like fire.
Nobody's got it.
First, you
got
to find a DeLorean.
So, Frank Scott.
So, well, we made a mixtape and it's 100 minutes long. And so they're 1 minute songs. Not a song that's a minute, but 1 minute of a song. So you can Rage and Tool and whatever, country, whatever the fuck you want to listen to.
So a Spotify mix.
Right. Spotify mix, whatever it is, but they can only be 1 minute long. And so you have all your cans of beer and I think you end up going through about 10. So you need about 10 cans of beer per person. And the game is who can make it all the way through the Century Club. And it's just taking a shot of beer. So every time a new song comes on, you take a 1 ounce shot of a beer. And then you just...
100 ounces?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It adds up. Yeah.
That's gross.
Yes. So 100 ounces of beer. It's beer. So, but it's crazy because when you start getting to... You start off and you're like...
Yeah, it's easy.
Every time I've started this game at parties when I was younger... You know, and you teach it to somebody, they always are like drinking a beer with it because it's too slow. Like, oh, this is too slow.
They start doubling up.
About 30, 40 songs in,
you're starting to feel the buzz kick in because of how fast you're taking these 1 ounce shots. And before you know it, you're pretty hammered playing this game. And not a lot of people can finish the full 100 songs.
That's terrible.
It's a great game, though.
Check this out. We are in January. We have our 30-day workout for free, which is programmed by us. So every single day on our YouTube channel, Mind Pump TV, you'll get a new workout every day. Some of them are actual workouts. Some of them are mobility sessions that you could do at home. Some of them are isolation-based movements or compound movements. It progresses you as you move along. If you go to YouTube, you can tune into the first one and follow along. If you're already following along, awesome. We love it. All you got to do is go to Mind Pump TV, subscribe to the channel so you get notifications every time we post one of those videos.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.